Hi everyone, today I'm going to answer your questions about grief. This time last year, roughly, I attended an event called Shipmas, which was organised by the Grief Network, and it was such a great event. It was the first thing of any of its kind that I'd been to. It was an event put on for people, for young people who were bereaved, and it was essentially just like a casual drinks, and then there was a DJ and a comedy set and so on. I was so nervous going, and then just instantly fell in with a table of people and we just chatted. It was very loose. It didn't feel like the pressure of a support group, and it's been so beneficial for me, but I haven't been able to do that this year, of course, with the pandemic and so on. But that really marked a sort of turning point for me and my experience of grief. And also, as I've mentioned before, I work with a therapist, and my current therapist is incredible. I've been working with her for nearly 3 years now. And it's just been completely transformative. And I've had several therapists, but this one has been different for lots of different reasons. And not least, I'm sure, because I was in a place where I was ready to address a lot of the things that my grief highlighted and that my life was highlighting. But yeah, it has made me feel very comfortable talking about grief, but also has brought out a vulnerability in me that, even though it might seem through my disclosures on the internet like I am a quite openly vulnerable person, I'm really not. I put up walls all the time, my poor friends. But it's something that I've been working really hard on. I'm being vulnerable right now. So yes, I asked people to send in questions on Instagram and Twitter and over email about grief that I could talk about. And the first one was, I'd love to hear anything you have to say about sort of burying grief and experiencing it later and looking back and going, oh yeah, I haven't processed that yet, have I? If that rings true at all. And yes, that rings so extremely true. Something they don't warn you about grief is that it involves a lot of fucking paperwork. When my dad died, we had so many different things to sort out. I remember so clearly going to the Apple store with his laptop and a death certificate so that they would unlock the computer so I could get inside it. We had to sell our childhood home when my dad died because there was just a lot of debt and stuff. And just like all of the logistics involved in moving house were overwhelming. And especially when you had that added, very emotional, very sad thing going on with it. There's probate as a thing, and figuring out pensions, and figuring out, like, if you have debt, you have to write to these companies and basically say, like, bargain with them sometimes and say, like, well, I can't pay down this amount of money, but I can give you this. Is this acceptable? And it's just like this horrible process that you have to do for months and months and months. And I, in addition, was going into my final year of university. My dad died between my second and third year of uni. And then I had to like update my information on student loans, and then my student loans didn't come in for 3 months or something. And I was on student loans and maintenance grant and a maintenance loan. And I had to figure out my housing pretty last minute. And a friend's dad had put down the deposit on it for me, but then like needed the money back because it was like a grand. And he asked me for it a couple of times, and I had to just kind of ignore him for a bit because I couldn't give him, I didn't have that money to give him. It was all these sorts of stresses that I think made me have to choose to, in order to survive that moment, put what I was feeling, all of that grief, into a side carriage for later. And then it feels like, oh no, I am addressing this because I've put it down there. I have processed this because I'm able to talk on some level about this grief. But actually down the line, especially like 6 or 7 years down the line, even though it had kind of been in my head throughout that process, I really, really knew that I just hadn't processed that grief. And and I would go into sessions with new therapists and be like, my dad died, here were the circumstances. I don't think I've really worked through that yet. And they'd be like, okay. And we'd go through it, and it never really felt like it was able to permeate the wall that I put up in order to be able to keep going. And that's the thing, like, that's such like a key therapy thing in general that you learn, but also just healing from trauma thing that you learn, is that the ways in which you come up with coping strategies, or your brain comes up with coping strategies, or your body in general comes up with coping strategies as a way to look after and protect yourself. But then sometimes those strategies morph into something that is unhelpful and sort of maybe blocking you from accessing certain kinds of feelings or experiences. And the way that I've found in unison with everything else, the way I found through that is by, when those strategies pop up, being able to say, okay, thank you for your suggestion, or thank you for your offer of help, but I'm going to try something new here. And learning to sort of speak to myself in those voices, all that self-talk stuff, actually does create these really positive feedback loops. And that's been my way into even beginning the process of processing it. The other thing that I realized quite recently, when I was writing my NaNoWriMo story, is that I went to quite vulnerable places in it, and the character has lost her father too. And I was describing the moment of the death of her father, and I realized and had this moment of sharp realization, there's literally a line of dialogue from The West Wing, to remember an experience without reliving it. Like, that traumatic, post-traumatic experience of every time you remember an experience, reliving it in the moment, and the panic of it and the fear of it, and that being completely arresting, and now being at a point where that's not the case. There have been so many indicators throughout the year of how much progress I've made, and yeah, how there was a time of 7 years or so where I was keeping myself in this sort of void place in order to protect myself, but then it was a bit of a double bind, and it ended up being at times a bit of a self-sabotage situation, but like not always. So yes, I identify with that. That it has really been a process of finding out what it takes for me to be vulnerable. And then also, that's not the end of the road, like understanding what happens then, when I'm vulnerable then, what are the consequences of that? I keep thinking about how every person who has met me after the loss never knew the me that wasn't plagued by grief. I guess I'm asking how you managed to hold space to grieve the you that was or could have been. Oh man, that's such a, I feel like, especially in my 20s, just because this is the experience I've had and known, I've experienced that so many times. I'm meeting people all the time who did not know me in secondary school or uni, who never met my dad, who don't even know, like who haven't met my family in general, and don't know the person that I was then. And it's really difficult. It's really difficult. Just that sense of like, meeting people who've never met my dad is such an abstract thought to me still, even after all this time. And the sense of the me who could have been and who might have been, like, I think this is really true whenever you lose someone, because it does change how you experience time and how you experience the world. But when I think of that in particular in my 20s, it's like, it's supposed to be this like really fun, carefree time. And I know everyone doesn't experience it that way, but like, you have all these different partners, and you go to like loud, crazy parties all the time, and you make somewhat reckless decisions. And there's just like a level of that that I feel like sometimes I feel like, oh, I missed out on that because I was trying to live in this new reality, and there wasn't really anything there or anyone there who could help me with that. Or at least that's what it felt like. I think in a lot of ways I had to deal with things on my own, because the people who could have or should have helped me deal with them at the time, for whatever reason, didn't. And so then I learnt that as my way forward through dealing with grief and stuff. And then it just became very isolating. Grief in general is so isolating, especially when you lose someone sort of, when you're like one of the first people to lose a parent, for instance, or you lose a sibling. Like, that's a very different kind of loss, I know, and has that same sense of this not existing in the same timeline as loss, like when other people lose grandparents who aren't parental figures, who are their grandparents, there's something like it's devastating, but it's also like expected in our timeline of what's supposed to happen in our like 10s and 20s and 30s and so on. So yeah, there is that sense of having to let myself be sad and allow myself to have those feelings of, oh, I want, and kind of that curiosity, I suppose, about, I wonder what my life would have been like had my dad not died. I do find that I really relish now conversations with friends from secondary school who I don't talk to as much as other friends, but there's something in those conversations that's so special to me now because they knew me before, and because I don't even know what it is. They just knew what I was like and they met my dad, and like, there's something else there that makes them all the more special. But holding space for it, I think for me has meant allowing myself to be sad about it, and allowing myself to be sad that, like, you know, I think I've even said this before on here, like, I don't even know if I'll get married, and I don't even know if I were to get married in this other timeline that I'd, you know, have my dad give me away. But like, the absolute fact that that decision has been made for me, that my dad can't give me away, or that he can't meet a kid if I ever have a kid, or like, there's so much he's missed out on already, that feels unfair to me. And so I think I have to allow myself, make a space for that, just frank fucking unfairness of it. And that's okay. It's okay to be angry about it or sad about it or whatever it is you're feeling. I think so much of this in general is, at least for me, is going to be an encouragement to let yourself feel what you feel, because it is okay. That whole narrative of like, be strong, hold your chin up, all of that, like, I feel like I'm so against that, because I did that, and grief is the wolf at your door. Like, you have to let it in. It is part of your life now. And however unfair that is, it is part of your life now. And so you can sort of choose to live alongside it, or you can fight it, but either way, it's still there, you know? So that's been my experience of that. Luckily for me, I have a lot of diaries and things, so I can go back and read almost missives from, and that is probably part of the reason why I go back and read old diaries often, because it's sort of trying to like find clues of me before. But even then, like, I'm complaining about things all the time, or like, I'm not really talking about my day-to-day life and like the things that I miss. Like, I'm talking about the fact that I fancy this guy and like, why hasn't he messaged me back on MySpace? And so similarly, there's a question, has your grief at young age made you feel like you're both ahead and behind your peers in different ways? And also, has your experience of such a huge grief young then affected how you respond to other bereavements now you're older? So yes, I do feel, I think I had this feeling over the past few years of like panic of like, I'm behind, I've missed out, I've missed my window. And really ultimately that fear then ends up in, and I'm going to be alone forever because I am so damaged and so broken that I don't know how to love anymore. And it just becomes this really catastrophic thing and this catastrophic fear. I now sort of, I'm quite good at self-soothing now, I think, like just sort of reminding myself that where I am is okay. And also that, yes, I have experienced things that people are going to experience in their lives. And I've also started to process those experiences in really healthy, positive ways. And I'm in a different place. And to some degree, we're all in different places from each other, right? We're like the universe expanding into the thing with no edge, but all just kind of all the chairs in the room moving away from each other. I still don't really understand it, but I trust that it's probably true. There is, I think, some strange comfort in feeling, well, there's comfort and then there's also isolation in feeling like I have experienced something that other people haven't. And I get, on certain days, I am very gracious in that. If people say certain things quite flippantly, I just sort of like brush it off. But there are other times where it's really painful and you're sort of reminded really starkly that someone else hasn't gone through something. If they say, like, in a very casual, flippant way, like, I wish, I don't know, like I was in a situation once where someone said, like, I wish their dad were dead. And I was just like, I'm sitting right here. So they're all different kinds of grief, right? Grief isn't always about death, but I think sometimes the way the word grief is used quite casually can sometimes feel like, can you just use a different word? Because I don't feel like, it's like that Inigo Montoya, I do not think that word means what you think it means situation. There is a certain part of that that I'm allowed to do, and whether or not it's literally accurate, it is because I have been pushed into this quite isolating experience of experiencing grief before most of my peers. So it's an odd thing, and I sort of allow myself the space to like feel that resentment and feel that anger and that bitterness occasionally. And then in making the space for feeling it, I find that it often sort of passes through. It doesn't become anything about the character of the person, just something that happens because they haven't gone through what I've gone through, you know? I think I had to grow up quickly, and not just because of the loss of my dad. I think in general, I grew up quite quickly. There were a lot of things that I sort of took on quite early, and felt like I had to. It has made me experience bereavement differently as an adult, yes, but it's also made me feel a level of anxiety about loss that I think is directly tied to the fact that I lost my dad very suddenly, and didn't get to say goodbye as well. And I really note this, like a really clear example of this was that I recorded conversations with my granny, and I'm so glad I did. My granny like was 19 when World War II started. I have a video up from a trip to Bath, and it has all the audio from a some of the audio from a conversation I had with her. And yeah, I recorded a few of our conversations, and still do take care to write to people and be quite open about my love for them. People who have lost someone close to them say I love you so much more. Like, I say I love you to my friends all the time. Partly because I know that, you know, love is the other side of loss. And also partly because I have this very real anxiety that they're just going to go one day. So, like, it has made me approach bereavement differently in that in some ways I'm prepared for it. But also what I'm prepared for is, like, how absolutely devastating it is. Like, it doesn't make that hurt less. So yeah, that's, I don't know. I think like there's a level of, at least with me, trying to find like an upside to this. And there are in ways, like I feel like I have a different understanding of life and the universe and like love and all of that than I used to. But it also, like the cost of that is so huge. I lost my brother to cancer when I was 14, he was 18, and since then I've been very close to my parents, but there is this empty hole, dark cavern that still echoes his presence when we are together, and it feels like we are all still lost and searching for him. How do we get out? I'm so sorry, and I also, I don't feel like I have an answer for you, but I also really know that feeling, and I think that's why in part this time of year can be so difficult, because you can see an empty place at the table, or you're buying Christmas presents, and like there have been several times that I've gone up to the till with something for like my granny or my dad, and then realised like, oh yeah, he's dead, or thought about something to give them, and even 9, nearly 10 years on, remembered, oh, he's dead. And it's gutting every single time. Each of you and your parents have lost a different person. Like, your brother is a different person to you than he was to your dad and he was to your mum. And maybe, I don't know if you've talked about that, but maybe that's part of what will help with that healing. Obviously there are certain things and sort of like certain trodden paths for ways in which you can celebrate his life and the things you miss about him and like the things that he liked. That's part of why I love Dia de Muertos so much, because it's like you have their favorite drink and their favorite food out for them, and it is like the living and the dead for one night are in this same place, and it's all about light and pictures of them and colour. But at the same time, there is a void there, you know? I guess my kind of question, reading your question, would be, is the void just where he is? Or is it something about all of your grief for him that you all or individually like haven't started to process or look at yet? Because that might help you find a way to just have it not feel so fucking painful all the time, you know? Like, have it not feel like this cavern at your table rather than a space where there should be a person. But yeah, I don't really know what else to say to that really, other than I really empathize with it. And if anyone in comments has ideas or words for any of this, then please do share them as well. I will also say there are some great communities, like Instagram is sort of my way into most of them, but great communities for people who have lost parents or siblings, or who are just exploring loss in general. There's podcasts like The Griefcast. I listen to the Daddy Issues podcast a lot, and there's several other ones as well, and some more specifically to having lost a sibling. And discovering that was so helpful because, for whatever reason, like, I hadn't until last year started to look for those places. I didn't really know that they existed, but they're actually like vast communities. And I found that helpful too. Do you find it hard to be around people who don't get it? I feel like there are two kinds of people who have suffered and people who never have. The latter act like comfort and peace are their God-given rights, and I find them alien and abhorrent. Wrong of me, but yeah. I do find it hard to be around people who don't get it. Especially when I feel like my suffering and my pain or my grief isn't being heard in the way that I need it to be heard, for whatever reason. And often, especially like in the earlier years of this experience, I guess you could call it, it was often because people had never known someone who had had someone close to them who died. Like, some of them had parents who lost a parent, but most of them had grandparents too, you know? Like, it was just very new. It was very new, and the default response from a lot of people was just like, oh, she probably doesn't want to talk about it, you know? we can't bring it up because then she might remember. And like, it's like in option B, like, you're not going to say anything that's going to remind me what has happened and who has died. I think about it all the time, you know? And I think that sometimes that it can be really frustrating, like that, like having to sort of accommodate other people's discomfort, I find really challenging. And less so now, but I think initially especially, like, made me feel quite sort of resentful, like all of those situations where you end up comforting someone else. And it can also be difficult to even understand what yourself. So someone else asking me like, what do you need? I'm like, I don't know. I've never done this before. What do I need? But often it's someone kind of muddling through that question with you and being patient until you sort of work it out, or even just talk about not knowing, can be so comforting. But yeah, I do sometimes really struggle to be around people who don't get it. Coming up 6 years since my dad passed, how have you dealt with crossing the it'll never happen to me line? I get anxiety whenever the phone rings or someone's on a big trip, etc., because all bets are off, it feels like. Oh yeah, and I have really felt this during the pandemic year. I think that at the very beginning, I actually felt like I was, you know, coping all right because we were all having the same or a similar experience at the same, you know, at the same time. Whereas my grief was very unique to me, and other people couldn't experience it, and that was very isolating. But quickly, I realized, as I've realized many times before, that yes, that crossing that line of like, here is, I'm experiencing something that I thought would never happen, or that I thought would happen at a very different time. Like, that just the world flips. The world flips. What's possible changes. All bets are off, as you say. And I have less anxiety than I used to. about things like the phone ringing. I have more anxiety than I used to about going, whoa, as you can see, more anxiety than I used to, about going elapsed periods of time without checking in with people, about, yeah, big trips for sure. Like the idea of not being able to get back in time is always really upsetting to me. You live in a different reality from everyone else. We live in a different reality from everyone else. Like that's kind of why I want to make this video as well. Like when I say you're going through this, you're experiencing that, what I actually mean is we have experienced something, even though our experiences of it are very different. We live in a different reality to people who haven't lost someone, who haven't had a phone call with the worst news in the world. One thing I've had to say to everyone close to me is never ask for a phone call without making at least slightly clear what you need to talk to me about. That thing of like, can I call you? I can't deal with that. I can't deal with that because the moment I see that, I'll just assume someone's dead. I just assume it. That's where my brain is. And, you know, part of that through like CBT and stuff, I kind of loosen the thread of that. But then I also like, I can just ask people for ways in which they can help me as well. We understand something fundamental that many people haven't been made to understand yet, and they will. And it's odd because you also like, you don't want the people you love to go through something terrible. Catastrophizing is something that I used to really struggle with that I don't as much now. This thing could happen, and then this thing could happen, and then this thing could happen, and then the apocalypse could happen, and then my friend or loved one will die, and then I will never speak to them again, and I know exactly what that feels like, and that's horrible. And so that's going to happen because this thing happened. And actually I've found ways through therapy mostly to sort of like veer off, to sort of like check that behavior kind of early on, and again self-soothe and reassure myself that just because this thing is happening doesn't mean that thing's going to happen. It's something I've worked on a lot, that sense of like updating that feeling of something being a clear and present danger. I associate with like a certain feeling I have, whether it's an anxiety or a fear or I don't know, just sort of like a traumatic memory of some kind. And that triggering, really, that sense of like, this thing is absolutely going to happen, and a certainty of it, and a very animalistic sense of like, that's going to happen right now and I have to prepare for it. And actually realizing that that's not quite up to date, or like that's being flagged in me because I have experienced something very traumatic, and that's very understandable, has calmed a lot of that down. But so I don't think that the way you might be experiencing this right now will be how you experience it forever, but I do think that you have been kind of, the way I think of it is like, you've been very close to the underworld and you can't forget that. You can't forget how close we're all living to like the world of the dead. Oh, I also want to say, because you included like, I'm coming up on 6 years now, I think that I definitely had a lot of feeling of like, all right, even if people weren't saying it to me, like, okay, it's been 5 years now, or it's been 6 years now, or 7 years now, whatever it has been, and now nearly coming up on 10 years in July, it's that sense of like, I should be at this certain place and I'm not right now. And you have to be so much more gentle with yourself, because you just have, it's such a difficult thing to go through. It's such a difficult thing to lose someone so close to you. You're doing something and going through something and living a reality that's really hard. And we have to be so kind to ourselves and gentle and patient with it. And it can feel, it's exhausting as well. Like going through a grief is relentless. It really is, because it is part of your life. But it won't always be part of your life in the shape that it is now. It will change, and it will sort of morph into different things. And sometimes those things are scary, and sometimes those things are really not, and will feel like part of your life in a very real way. But yeah, I think don't judge yourself for still feeling a lot of grief, a lot of anxiety, a lot of fear 6 years on, because there's no timeline for this. what you have to make sure you're doing is looking after yourself and listening to what you need and reaching out for support as well. Whether that's through formalized things like therapy or bereavement groups, or just like reading up about experiences online or listening to podcasts, things like that, opening up to friends to a degree. But I think it is really helpful to talk to like professionals and people who've gone through it as well, because as you say, there's like it's a different world. I'm just going to keep repeating that, like it's a different world we live in. I've been thinking a lot lately about disclosure. I have a new job and a new housing situation, and it's making me think how between 2016 to 2018 I told everyone about my dad all the time, and it sort of bit me. Last few years I've disclosed much less, but then it feels like I'm hiding something myself. What have your waves been like around disclosure? That's a really interesting question. I have now become someone who will just drop it into the conversation. Like, my dad died, so this, that, and the other. Or like, oh, well, my dad's dead. And I say it very finally, and it's almost, as I think, a way of protecting myself so that questions don't come up that feel really... I feel like they will push on something because the other person doesn't know. I'm not saying that's sort of like the right way to do it. And then there have been times when I haven't really told anyone about it, or when I've pretended that he's still alive because it's been easier to get through that conversation by just sort of like creating this fictional situation. And like, it does feel in many of those cases like I'm forgetting something of myself, or like I'm not present. But it's almost in allowing myself to try different models for addressing those kinds of questions, or like saying them up front, depending on where I'm at in my own grief. I think that's always a thing. It's like, how does it make you feel to say that? Like, if it makes you feel like you are missing something of yourself, then maybe you do disclose it a little more. But you don't also, like, you don't have to disclose anything you don't want to. Like, it's not an essential required part of the process of connecting with other people. But there is a level of like, if you don't feel like you're being your real self, or if you feel like you are kind of protecting yourself by holding yourself back and being a bit more absent, then maybe that's something to think about. I don't know. It's so hard though. Like, it definitely does like throw. I remember earlier this year, I went to see the film Onward, right before the pandemic, like, shut everything down. I went to see the film Onward, which is just, like, there are certain things in that film's plot that are so similar to how my dad died, that I was, and just sort of my experience of the grief, that I just, to say I sobbed is an understatement. I cried so hard. And then there was, as there are after these screening events, there was like an after party thing. And I saw my friend Iman, and I hadn't seen him in a while. He was like, how are you doing? And I was like, oh, well, my dad's dead. So, and that to me felt like a very natural thing to say in this context. Like, my dad's dead, so like currently I'm feeling quite sad after that film. But what I actually did was just like really like throw a little axe into the conversation. And just kind of like, I don't know, just made it difficult, because my head was like so in that place. And that's fine, like now I obviously laugh about it, but that was, I suppose, the way that in that moment I could cope with like being there and then also feeling everything that I was feeling. I then proceeded to drink far too much Prosecco at that party, but like, for the moment, saying very bluntly, well, my dad's dead, was oddly cathartic, because it was exactly how I felt. So yeah, I don't know, there are different approaches. There are definitely different approaches. But also sometimes inventing, you know, a living father who resembles nothing to my father and has a career in advertising or something, it can be a strangely fun exercise as well. I don't know. I'm going to answer one more question and then I will wrap up this video here, because otherwise it will be 2 hours long. Maybe I'll do a second part if that's something you'd be interested in. I also wanted to make a video, because I've made a video about books that have helped me process and experience grief. I'll do one about like films and television programs and stuff as well, and other things in life that have helped me process grief. But anyway, I'll wrap that up here. But my last question I got was how to cope with the first holiday season without a loved one or without a parent that you've recently lost. And the biggest advice I have here is like, it's going to be sad. It is going to feel different. It will be tough for you to hear about friends going back to their family homes if they go back to their family homes, or even just talking about, oh, I'm like really sad that I can't go back this year because I really want to see my parents, and like that will sting in a different way. So I just want to say that up front. And it can be helpful to say in quite clear terms, this holiday season is going to be quite different for me. I just wanted to say that, just to kind of say that up front and just sort of like put out how you're doing. You don't have to, but I've found that helpful over the years. If you have like regular Christmas traditions or holiday traditions, you don't have to do those things this year. Some people might want to because it feels like sort of natural to them, or it feels like a way of being in touch with their loved ones. But for me, like inventing new traditions and finding new ways to spend this month has been really helpful, and has felt very honest in terms of like it's parallel with how I'm actually feeling. So it feels like it's something manageable and like I can do. So yeah, I think it can be difficult, especially because it is a time of family. You feel like, oh, I have to be there for this person in my family or that person in my family, or I owe it to them. And while you might feel that, what you really have to do is look after yourself. And you have to put yourself first and listen to yourself. So if there are times in a holiday environment where you do want to retreat and rest for a bit, or read a book for a bit, or watch a film or play a video game, do that and stick up for yourself doing that. That's also what I'd say. But yeah, it's difficult, but we're all here for you. as you've no doubt heard from however long this has been going, there are a lot of people who are in this strange club, as I like to think of it. If you need to, you can come back here and read comments, or you can find other places online. I'm gonna drink this glass of wine now. Before I go, I just want to say thank you to everyone who sent in questions and who has shared their experience, whether that's on this video or over the years. And like, I will never forget how kind you've all been in the nearly 10 years since my dad died. And I made a video that's literally called My Dad Died, which is not the video you were expecting after my first ever VidCon in 2011. You've all been so wonderful, and I get comments and things saying like, oh, it's been really helpful to watch these or that videos about your experience with grief, but like, it's been so helpful to be part of this community and be able to share them and have people who will really listen to those experiences. Thank you. But yeah, now I'm going to have a little weep, edit this video and drink this lovely glass of wine, which I've made into a bit of a spritzer with a bit of Sprite that I had. Because I was going to say because it's Friday, but it's Thursday. Anyway, what are you going to do? All right. Bye.